Wow, the light here is... I'll try to step here so at least I don't get too much light on me. A lot of people, I'm not used to speak to so many people, so I'm a little bit excited. One of the things that Ben just said before is, you know, for the first time that he actually saw someone using his invention, the reward is outstanding. Now, in Israel, there are about half of the drivers are using Waze. And obviously, everyone recognized the brand and the application. And I cannot even walk with this T-shirt in the street because people are going to approach me every time and either saying, you know, you just saved my day yesterday because you, otherwise I would be stuck in traffic or something like that. Or they would start to complain that why this one and this one, this one doesn't work. You know, the biggest reward is when you have people approaching you and telling you that you saved their day. So Waze is a social network of drivers, and essentially you can think of you know, Wikipedia approach of user-generated content, and Twitter approach of real-time connectivity, and Facebook approach of a social network, and put them inside the car. And that will be Waze. It's a social network of drivers that creates their own content in real time and share them among themselves. And essentially, we're trying to answer a very simple question. Which route should I take right now? And essentially, the focus of the application is on the daily driving, so not necessarily navigation. Navigation is something that we are all using when we need to get to some place that we don't know how to go there. But daily driving is what we are doing every day. We are going to the office, we are going to work, we are going to the gym, we are going to multiple places. And for each one of them, the focus is, you know, which route should I take right now? The application itself helps you drive smarter by providing you with the information of what's going on the roadways that is actually coming from other drivers like you. So you would see where other drivers are, you would see how fast they're moving, and in addition, the system itself will take that into consideration when it's you know, calculating the route for you and providing you with the information of what's going on the route. If you let the system know, then the system actually learns your patterns of use and understand that, okay, Monday morning you're going to the office, Tuesday morning you're going, first of all, to the gym and so forth, and automatically calculate the route for you and provide you with the estimated time of arrival and the recommended route and the alternative routes. So not only that this route is going to take 30 minutes, this one is actually the one that you took yesterday is going to be 35 minutes, and that's why you should be taking the 30 minutes route. So the application helps you essentially drive smarter. It is a turn by turn, so you would have voice guidance, turn left and right and so forth, sometimes would have something like that. So if one driver reports that there is a road hazard or police or traffic jams or accident, then the next driver will actually get the warning of that. And essentially, all the things that we have on top of the map and also the map itself are all generated by the users. And so it's in that sense, it's a user-generated or a driver-generated concept of what we are saying. And let me just show you one example here, and then I'll show you a little bit of how does it work underneath the hood. This is Los Angeles, probably more vehicles in Los Angeles than any other metropolitan area in the world, 5:09 p.m., middle of the rush hours. Google say that it's going to be 1 hour and 10 minutes, and Waze basically say that it's going to be 23 minutes. And the reason is that you can see the route over there, that essentially we were the route was driving on the 405 highway and then getting off the highway into the street level. And at the end of the day, if we are thinking of traffic information, then essentially there is only one thing that we care about. Should I get off the highway or not? And the highway was looked pretty jammed, and essentially when we got off the highway, then the street level was pretty clear. And we were able to go maybe even 44 miles per hour on the street level, and eventually it took us 26 minutes to get there instead of 1 hour and 10 minutes. Now this scenario, this example actually happens in LA every day. To most of the drivers, it happens to them that there is always a better route than what they think, and it's always significant. In Israel, when the number of routes are somewhat, the number of alternatives is somewhat more limited, then not always we have a so significant better route. But it does happen quite a lot that there is a traffic jam, there is an accident, there is something along the route that you should have been taking on a normal day. And because we know what's going on the roadways, we can help you to avoid that. The underneath the hood, or maybe the rocket science behind Waze, is what we call the driver-generated live map. So essentially, when someone is driving, then we collect the GPS from the smartphones in real time, and we collect the GPS very frequent. And essentially, when we have a lot of those, then it's starting to look like a map. So we actually build a map based on where people are driving. And this map is actually a reflection of the reality. So if I will tell you that over there it's a traffic circle, it definitely looks like a traffic circle. And if you look at a thicker line over there, then it's a main street compared to different streets and so forth. And you know, if there are 100 people that are going in one direction and no one is going on the other directions, that will be one-way street. And if there are 100 people going in one direction and only 5 going the other direction, that will be one-way street in Tel Aviv. So this is how we drive. And based on that, we can actually create the map, right? And so we generate what we call the navigable road grid out of that, that we can actually route on that grid. I can barely see it here, so I assume that you can barely see it over there. But this is not a complete map, right? This is where we bring the community to help us. And essentially, they provide us with street names, and they provide us with additional attributes of the map. And today, we have about 150,000 map editors, people that are going into the map and editing the map, providing information, providing street names, providing house numbers, providing points of interest, creating new roads that are not yet on the map, fixing interchanges, doing all the map editing tool, the heavy lifting of the map creation, and they're doing that because they care and because it's for them. Every week we have about 2,000 new map editors like that. And then obviously if someone is all of a sudden driving slow, then we know exactly that there is a traffic jam here. And remember that we collect the GPS every second. So I can even tell the difference between someone, you know, stuck in traffic, that the patterns look like a driving go, versus someone that is pulling into a gas station or something like that. And we can even determine traffic jam based on a single vehicle. Obviously, when we have a lot of users, then this is where it's starting to work like magic. Now, unfortunately, we don't have enough users today, only 29 million users. And obviously, this is a matter of localization. So in some places, we have enough. In some other places, we don't have enough. And I will skip some of that just to show you how actually map is being created. So one interesting thing is, you know, the first driver that drives somewhere is actually driving on a blank page. And actually, the car avatar, or the avatar on the application, turn into a roller steamer that they can pave the road as they drive. And this road that is being paved as they drive is actually being used by the rest of the drivers tomorrow morning. Video, please. So what we have, what we don't have on the video, okay, what we do have on the video, is actually a snapshot of a few places in Eastern Europe that how the map was created. So essentially what we are seeing is the date on the corner, and we can see that the map is being created. It will zoom in into the center area, and this is Bratislava, and this is 100% user generated. So when we started in December 2009, there was a blank page. After maybe 6 months or so, then the map was maybe at par with, so this is the center area. From time to time, you will see red dots, like here. And the red dot means that someone reported that there is an error on the map. Obviously, there are a lot of errors on the map at the beginning. And it's being removed when someone else from the community is actually fixing that problem. And then over time, you know, we created the map of Bratislava, or not we, but the community created the map. They created the map of pretty much everywhere that we have maps, that we have enough users. And this is Prague in the Czech Republic and so forth. Can we go back to the presentation, please? turn the video off and go back to the presentation. So this is it's okay, keep that on. So this is traffic in Los Angeles from it's a 24-hour snapshot, and it's going from Sunday afternoon, Sunday evening, Sunday night into Monday morning rush hours. What we are seeing here, the dots are active reports by drivers. So some of them will be police or road hazard or traffic jams, and during the night usually what we are actually seeing is a driver chat between themselves. And then the color coding, which could be yellow or orange or red, are traffic jams. No, keep the video, that was perfect. Video, please. So during the night, nothing there, right? This is Los Angeles, this is not Madrid. Madrid, there is probably traffic throughout the night, but Los Angeles, they actually go to sleep at night. Now around 6, 7 a.m., we are starting to see the rush hours of LA, and you can even see the traffic crawling into the city from the south, and then from on the 101 from the north, and so forth. And obviously, during the rush hours in Los Angeles, this is, looks like a discotheque, essentially. And LA is we have about 1 million users in Los Angeles, successful. Metropolitan area for us. Back to the presentation. And so essentially all these is created by the community. And if we're looking, during the rush hours in the US, and this is when we still had only 7 million users there, there are probably 11,000 traffic jams that we detect as a system, and 36,000 reports by users. And this is more traffic information than any other source of information. And one of the interesting things is, and this is probably going back into the issues of crowdsourcing, and so let me start with the story of LA. Today, the ABC channel in the television in LA is using our traffic information, and they broadcast the traffic information in many metropolitan areas. But when they started, they asked us, how do you know that if someone reports that there is an accident, the accident is actually there? And we were spending some time with them, and then we said, first of all, we don't know. Right? We actually don't know. We don't validate the information, and we don't know if they actually have whatever is being reported is actually there. But we do develop the community tools so they can validate that. And so if someone were to report that there is a speed trap, next driver is actually going to get a warning, be careful, speed trap ahead of you, right? And it will show them how far away is that, and once they get to the spot, it will ask them whether or not it's still there or not. And so the next driver responsibility is to validate the information or to say that it's not there. And then we told them, and if this is not enough for you, then you can always go and test that out, right? Now, the only thing that we didn't figure out is that ABC actually have helicopters. And they send them over to validate the information provided by the community. And after a few days, they came back and they said everything that the community reported was actually true. Now let's look at a few issues with crowdsourcing, because as I say, the map is generated by the users, and we don't validate anything. And so what prevents me of going into the map editing tool, going into Gran Via and change that to be Uri Levine Boulevard? And so the reality is that there are two things that prevents that. One is that I haven't driven enough in Gran Via, so I will have significant credentials to change that, and probably it's such a major street that only the area manager would be able to modify that. And number two, if I would do that, then the community would know that it's inaccurate, and instantly they will fix it. And so, but I can, by the way, I can go into the driveway to my house and call that Uri Levine Boulevard, and number one, no one wouldn't know that it's not the case, and number two, no one cares. And so, in our map, or in our traffic, or in our data, if no one went there, then I don't know anything about it. But at the same time, I would say, if no one is going there, then why should I care about that place? Vanishing trap, very, very interesting. So at the early days, the police came to us and they told us that we are you know, we are interfering with the police work, and you know, we ask them what is the police work, and they say we need to make sure the driver are driving safe and slow in places that we think is important. And we say, you know, we are helping you, right? Because we warn them that there is speed trap, and therefore everyone slows down. And after a while, they figure out that in order for them to be successful in whatever they think is their work, is they're actually to use Waze themselves. So police in Israel and police in many other places are using Waze, and every time that their trap is being discovered, they're actually moving to a different location. So they're seeing that they're being discovered, they move to a new location and so forth. And I have a few friends that volunteers in the traffic, in the highway patrol center in Israel, and I ask them how frequent do they move, and they say every 3 minutes. So essentially the information is becoming very, very good. One of the interesting things is that we have discovered our top iPhone developer from the community that basically came up with a few ideas and then implemented them on the iPhone. And then we say, you know, this guy rocks, let's have them on board. And so we hired him. Recently, we were recommended by Tim Cook. Obviously, that was doing a lot of good job in terms of PR for us. But if we're looking at where we are, you know, that slide was, I was forced to send the slides about 10 days ago. So you can now figure out how much we are growing in 10 days. It's about a million users in 10 days. The interesting thing is that we are actually, the growth pace that we have is pretty significant. But in terms of, you know, what we have on the back end of it, is that our storage, our usage capacity are doubling itself every 3 months. And there are many places, you know, when we launched, we had about 20 new users a day. Now we have about a new user every second. And Israel is always a model for us. We started in Israel. We have 1.4 million active users there. And during the rush hours, one out of five will be using Waze. So obviously, if there is a traffic jam of even five vehicles, I already know what's going on the roadways. We are approaching tipping point, and you know, this is a network effect, right? The more users that we have, the better information that we have for the community, and obviously when we have better information, it's easier to get more users. And so we are reaching the tipping point or the critical mass point in most of the places in the US, in many places in Europe, so Italy, France, Netherlands, Sweden, Spain not yet. But hopefully we will get there pretty soon. So we have about 700,000 users here, but we need maybe a million in order to, you know, reach the tipping point where the value of the information there is becoming competitive or becoming better than anything else. Latin America, pretty amazing, but most of the countries from you know, from Colombia, Mexico, Brazil, Chile, Venezuela, pretty much everywhere there. We reach critical mass, and so we are on the right track on 60% of the countries, or 60% of the countries on the globals, and there's still 40% more that we need to address. Let me try here something. We are going to launch next week a much more social version, and the story behind that is, or part of the story, is that 2 weeks ago I was supposed to pick up my 11 years old son from the after school, and you know, I was supposed to pick him up at 5 o'clock. I arrived into the gate at maybe 5 minutes before five, and I was waiting there, and at 5:05 I haven't seen him, so I called him. And I asked him, where are you? And he said, I'm waiting for you at the gate. And I figured out that probably he's maybe inside or so. So I stepped out of the car, I went to the gate, and he wasn't there. And so I called him again, and I said, where are you? And I said, I'm just by the gate. And I said, why don't you step out for a second so I will see you, right? And he said, I just stepped out, and I haven't seen him. And then I figured out that I'm actually at the wrong gate, or maybe he's at the wrong gate. And so I was, you know, driving around to the other gate, and meanwhile he figured out the same thing, and he, you know, he was walking to the other gate as well, and you know, I get to the other gate, he's not there. I was completely pissed. I drove home, and 45 minutes later, I had my son arriving crying and saying that I wasn't there, right? And so, and not necessarily I was a good father at the time, but the approach of some approach of exactly that is being implemented new version that we have. Can we play that?
You've been using Waze to bypass traffic, get real-time road alerts, and find the best gas prices, all by plugging into the world's largest community of drivers. But driving isn't just for getting yourself from one point to another. Much of the time you spend on the road, you're on the way to meet up with friends, pick up family, or join coworkers. That's what the new version of Waze is all about. Here's how it works. Picking up a friend is a piece of cake. Send a pickup request to get her location and navigate there with one tap. She'll get a live status of your ETA and watch as you approach. It works even if she doesn't have Waze. When you're driving to an event, see who else is headed there too.
So I will skip that, but the idea was that he will see on his phone where I am, and I will see on my phone where he is, and obviously I will see that he is on the wrong gate, and I will be able to pick him up. One of the things that we are recently doing is actually going into a little bit into the car. Not like that, even though that we have some trials like that. More like that. So this is an entertainment system that is actually connected to the iPhone or to the smartphones that you have. Can you play the video, please? And so the application is actually running on on the iPhone, but displays on the large display. And everything that you can do on the smartphone, you can actually do on the large display of the car. And this is available by Pioneer now. This is Honda, which is going to launch in the US this version, I think in January or so. And so in many cases, people ask us, what if I already have a system in the car? Turns out that car industry realized that it's much better to bring your own connectivity, to bring your own content, to bring your own everything into the car, and then use that simply there. So if I would like to, if I can summarize, the power of crowdsourcing, 11 years ago, there was no Wikipedia. Now today, there is no Britannica. And if we can understand the power of the community, and if we trust the community, and if we empower the community, and if we give them control, then they can do magic. Now globally, there are only four companies that owns maps, right? There are Teleatlas, which is acquired by TomTom. There is Navtec that was acquired by Nokia. And there is Waze and there is Google. These are the only four global companies that owns maps. And for two of them, they actually don't care how much it costs to make them. Google, because they actually don't care. And Waze, because it doesn't cost us. It's a community approach. It's built by the community. Today in Israel, we are saving about 1.5 million hours of traffic jams to the drivers every month. And if you translate that into money, that's maybe 40 million euros every month that we save to the community simply by keeping them out of traffic. Not to mention how many speeding tickets we are saving them. So I think this is it.
Thanks, Uri. Como siempre tenemos tiempo de preguntas. Por allí, ya muy rápido veo una. A ver.
Hi, Shalom Uri, Rav Todot. How do you address any privacy concerns with regards to all data which is stored in your systems, or maybe any kind of authority requesting access to those data in the future?
So when we started Waze, that was one of our biggest dilemmas. So how would people perceive the issue of, we know where they are? And so one of the biggest things that we decided is that we are on the side of the drivers. So it's us and the drivers are fighting the enemy, and the enemy are traffic jams and police. So essentially what we did in terms of the product is that by default, we create a random user ID for the user, and we don't even know who you are. And so even if the police will ask me where you have been last night, I don't even know who you are. And so that was the first way that to approach that. And then later on, we figure out that people really don't care. I mean, everything that they are doing is on Facebook anyhow, and most of the people don't care. But we still address that.
Bueno, adelante, Juan.
Hi, thank you. It was very interesting, and I guess you get this all the time, but what's your business model?
So we provide driver-based advertisement. We are doing that only after we reach a certain number of drivers. So for example, you know, if you're driving home, and I will tell you that gas stations 10 miles down the road is offering free coffee for you, then this is going to be valuable for you and obviously valuable for them. And so the focus is on providing advertisement, but under the perceptions of value to the drivers, focus is only on drivers and nothing else.
Yeah, I had a similar question up here. I had a similar question, and what's your business model? And I'm wondering, based on your answer, if you actually are breaking even, because the technology that you require to build this app, I don't know if it will be paid by coffee advertising.
To an extent, right now we are providing advertisement only in Israel, and obviously Israel is, even though that is relatively successful, it's a small market. And so it's not enough to pay for the entire organization. Eventually, what we have is that we have a lot of users that are using the application quite a lot. So the average use right now is about 7.5 hours every month, which is more than what most of the mobile users that are even speaking on the phone. And so therefore, we get a lot of opportunity, a lot of screen times, maybe even 15 times a month to show the advertisement. And according to our calculation, it should be enough.
Por aquí.
I was wondering that as the people are entering the data while they are driving, they're probably provoking accidents, so that's adding value to your model.
So. Most of the information that we collect is simply by you driving, right? So when you drive, we collect the GPS data from your phone, and based on that, we know exactly where you are and how fast you are going, and based on that, we can calculate where the traffic jams are. Now, usually when people report, then they, it's a single click to report that you have seen an accident or a traffic jam or something like that. In some countries, we already enable that through speech recognition. I can argue that if you report that you just saw an oil spill on the road, and by that helping the rest of the drivers, then it's much more important than the fact that you had to do something actively in order to report that. And to that extent, it's not about what they are going to do for us. It's about what we, the drivers, are going to help ourselves.
Shalom, Uri. It seems that the application is addressed basically to drivers. What about pedestrians or bicycles, whatever?
What about them? You know, it's. We are a startup company. We have to stay focused, right? And our focus is only on drivers. And so if you are a pedestrian or you need public transportation or you are a tourist or whatever, right? And anything else, if you are, riding your bicycles on mountain bikes in the dirt or whatever, Waze is probably not the right solution for you. There are many other applications that are pretty good for that. Sorry, I didn't hear that.
Prueba.
It's very hard for a startup company to figure out when is the right time to expand from the single focus and single agenda into multiple agendas. Right now, we have plenty of other things that we can help drivers. So. In the previous version, we figure out that drivers complain a lot and they care a lot about the gas prices, so we implemented that. Now we are allowing driving to band together and drive together. We're also looking at parking as a major issue, so if you're driving into metropolitan areas and parking is an issue, then find me the best, an empty parking or an available parking is a much bigger issue. than dealing with a pedestrian or public transportation or anything else. So right now, we don't even think about it. Can I say that we wouldn't think about it in 5 years? You know, I don't know.
Well, no more questions. Thanks, Uri. Thank you very much.
Okay. Thank you.